So, hey everyone. You may have seen me around. I'm a PhD student here at SFU. And today I'm going to be presenting on something a little different than what I usually research on. I'm taking a qualitative methods course, so I thought I'd kind of try out my study on you guys first. So I'm studying how lucid dreamers use their lucid dreams for introspection. And I want to know what their experiences are around self-knowledge, introspection, how they reflect in their dreams on themselves. And so I have a background in psychology and computer science. And my kind of life goal, if you will, is to use technology as a way to help people in some way. And I'm really interested in mental well-being. I volunteer for the Vancouver Crisis Center, so I'm always looking for ways to use technology in a more positive way. So then I came to Bernhard's lab, and they're doing some cool stuff with virtual reality, and some other people are doing stuff with biofeedback. And then also on the neuroscience side, this is more my background, and cognitive science as well, understanding how people behave, how they perceive the world. And I'm also a lucid dreamer. So lucid dreaming means being aware that you are dreaming while in the dream. So you're dreaming and you're like, wait a minute, this can't be real. And what's kind of cool about that is you can influence the dream to be whatever you want. So you can fly around, you can be the hero of your own story, or you can just kind of go with it. And that really reminded me of kind of virtual reality. Lucid dreaming is kind of like the ultimate VR, because it's only limited by your imagination, whereas in VR it's more constrained to the programming and the experience that people make. On the neuroscience side, people have already started looking into lucid dreaming, and yeah, it's a real thing. What they did is told people to make certain eye movements when they lucid dreamt, and they could actually do that, and they saw that. Then they thought, how could I maybe induce lucid dreaming in people? So they took this AC current and hooked it up to their skulls. And people who have never lucid dreamed before, they stimulated these brain waves, and they were able to lucid dream about 70% of the time. So that's really cool. But the problem with that is it doesn't really get at what the purpose of lucid dreaming for, like, introspection is. It's more the practice around lucid dreaming that's really beneficial. You know, it's being aware of your environment. What's, you know, what's real, what's not real. It's looking at yourself and your feelings, like, what am I feeling right now and why? So I wanted to take kind of these two things and kind of bridge them together and meet. And I think technology is a great way to do that, because people are more welcoming of new technologies, whereas just with lucid dreaming practices, it's really a laborious task. You need to train yourself to do it. It's also associated more with, like, spirituality, which some people aren't really into. So technology could be a cool way to explore introspection and your own thoughts and feelings in a playful way. Okay. Yeah, so what do I mean by lucid dreaming? I already talked about that. Introspection is examining your own thoughts and feelings, looking inwards. And self-knowledge is asking, like, who am I as a person? It's yourself and your properties kind of informs, like, what who you are in the world, your personality. Yeah. So in a nutshell, I want to study introspection and lucid dreaming so that I can inform the design of a system that uses biofeedback, virtual reality, all these things together to create an experience so people can better understand their feelings, their thoughts, and hopefully that will impact them in a positive way mentally. Okay, so in this research, I was looking at what are the experiences of introspection and self-knowledge in lucid dreaming, and what kinds of images, sounds, sensory stimuli some people feel, touch or taste or smell, what sorts of moments are associated with introspection and in lucid dreaming, and then what are the relationships to the feeling, tone, and intensity of the emotional stimuli. So something feels really emotionally charged, or is there a shift in affect, then why is that, and what sorts of sensations are associated with that? Yeah. So this research will ultimately look at the characteristics of lucid dreamers, their experiences around lucid dreaming and introspection, and what they think is happening there. So this is a phenomenological study, which means I'm looking at kind of the essence of what it is to be a lucid dreamer and specifically using it for introspection. So I used some semi-structured interviews. So this is looking at in-depth interviews with individuals, really getting at what their experiences are from their perspective. I wanted to look at active and proficient lucid dreamers. So they had to be current lucid dreamers, having lucid dreams, and having them often. So, you know, it's not just, oh, I remember this one time I thought I knew I was dreaming. I wanted to look at the experts or pros because I think they could give me the most insights. And Stephen LaBerge, who's the big psychologist who looks at lucid dreaming from Stanford, he recommends that if you're studying lucid dreaming, that you also use active and proficient lucid dreamers. Then I also wanted to use broad and open-ended questions. So I just had a few really broad questions. As Boyan recommends, if you're doing a phenomenological study, you should use really open-ended questions and not be too specific, because you want the participant to really open up about what their experiences are. And it's really interesting, too, because you never know what people are going to say, and it could be something that you never thought about before. Okay. So what I did is, so far, still in progress, I met with three individuals separately just at a cafe, and that was their choosing. So I asked them, like, where are you comfortable in talking about your experiences? I wanted to give it up to them so it wasn't in a very constrained or laboratory condition, which might give, like, an imbalance of power. Because it's kind of a sensitive topic and it's very personal in nature, I wanted them to be as comfortable and open as possible. I had some interviewing questions and prompts just to get the ball rolling, get some rapport established, and so they would be more open to sharing their experiences. So I asked some things like, tell me about how you became a lucid dreamer. It's just something really easy to start off with and kind of jogs their memory. Then later I put it more into context. So I asked them, like, oh, do you remember a specific instance where you felt like you were reflecting or you discovered something about yourself? So I got all the interviews, and I also wrote my own reflections at the end of each interview, and I think those are important because it shows if I have any biases and also things that I observed as well as what they were saying. So if they seemed more closed off or really open, that's really important. See if they're holding anything back. And then next, I'm using in vivo, which is a qualitative software, that I can look at the really significant statements or quotes, which I thought seemed important. Then I'm going to develop themes from those statements. And then I'm going to put it into a description of the participants' experience, but also the context and setting of where we were, and also of their dreams. I think it's really important that you mention the context of the dreams and kind of their history behind it, and not just what they reported. And then my own reflections, and then at the end I'll have a description of the essence of what it means to introspect using lucid dreams. And eventually I'll give it back to them and say, like, is this an accurate representation of what you think introspection and lucid dreaming looks like? So I've only done three people, but so far I've got like four rough themes. One of them is empowerment. And this is knowing that it's knowing that when you're dreaming, that it's not actually a dream, seems to empower them. So, for example, one participant said that there was this big kind of monster. They couldn't really describe it, but it was more of a feeling of this dark, shadowy figure. And, you know, they were afraid, but the moment they realized they were dreaming, that all went away. So the creature was still there, but there was no fear anymore because they know it couldn't hurt them. People often dream of people in their own life, maybe that they're having conflicts with. And one participant said that they had a big conflict with a colleague, and they were in the dream, like yelling at them. And when they realized it was a dream, they were able to talk to them and confront them. And so, you know, that conflict got resolved in their mind from the dream. There's also a sense of like freedom. So when you realize you can dream, you know, what's the first thing you want to do? Probably fly around. Lots of people like to do that. So yeah, there's no limits. One person described they flew from Vancouver across Canada all the way to Halifax, and they could see every detail along the way. And they said to me that they actually drove that many years ago, so they actually knew what it looked like, and they were re-exploring that in a dream. Another person said that they wanted to test the boundaries of the dream, so they went into outer space. And they kept going. They could see the planets and Saturn, but more from a distance. And, explore space. And then when they said they got too far from space, they could clench their fists and then return to Earth. There's also, tied to the theme, exploration. So a common theme in the participants was that they wanted to just explore. Even though they knew they were dreaming, they still didn't really exercise any control or change anything per se, but they went along with it and just wanted to see what happens. They also had a lot of reoccurring dreams where you have the same dream over and over again. But when you're lucid dreaming, you can start to change things and manipulate things and maybe explore a different part of that dream. And another theme is self-discovery. And one very interesting thing a participant said to me was that they have this dream like once every couple of months, where they see a few people who look like them, and they are them, and they know everything about them, but they also get this inkling that they know more than they know about themselves, like they have some secrets. And so when they try to talk to them, they start to tell them about these secrets. So it's almost like there are these people watching from, just watching them in their life, kind of looking out for them and saying, like, oh, I kind of know more than you know. And so it got them thinking about just the nature of, like, reality and what we know and what we don't know about ourselves and our environment. Also, they were able to ask questions about themselves, but of course they're just asking themselves. So it's kind of the unconscious becoming conscious. Yeah, so those were very interesting insights. Yeah, I think so far the experiences seem like, you know, there's a lot of emotionally charged dreams that they remember. Some people could taste, so they could eat something that they've never eaten before, and their brain just comes up with a random taste, what they think it might taste like. Another theme of introspection is just confronting fears, different things. So, like if you're swimming with sharks and you're afraid of sharks, if you realize it's a dream and start to calm your fear response, then, you know, the sharks don't attack you. So, yeah, I'm not entirely sure how this will go into, like, a technological experience yet, but still in early stages. And yeah, I'm really excited and interested about what other people have to say. So thank you. Any questions? Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah, that's a fascinating topic. And I don't know if while doing the research you also learned about dreaming itself, like not just lucid dreaming. But there's a lot of interesting things in modeling there. Regarding introspection during lucid dreaming, what type of introspection did you look at? Because you can think of several types. There's what I believe, and then there's more interesting things maybe about models of minds. When I build models of others, what I believe you believe, depending on, you know, the interaction we have in real life. Mm-hmm. And I wonder how those more indirect introspective dimensions get affected or not by the, and are accessible or not to the lucid dreamer.
I think for that definition of, you know, what do I believe, I think at least a couple of the people I interviewed said that they could start to kind of see how their reality might be different from others' reality, and that through the lucid dreaming they were able to kind of gain a new perspective on things. Yeah, so that was kind of interesting. Yeah, it's a introspection. Yeah, it's hard.
And how many of them are related to out of body experience? Like when the lucid dream are there? First person or third person?
Mostly it's first person. Yeah. One participant said that they had an outer body experience before, and it was slightly different than that. Yeah.
Plenty of questions.
Yeah.
Maybe Eve?
I'm also curious about introspection.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess at the first level, it could be just knowledge, but I think that's actually something really interesting. I mean, most phenomenological writers make quite a clear distinction between introspection and phenomenology, and part of the issue is that introspection kind of implies a mentalist attitude where everything's happening in the mind. And so for most phenomena, it's a valid critique, but then in this case, actually is. So there's a really interesting case here. But I wonder if you're using this also to talk about this relation between introspection and phenomenology.
Mm. Yeah, that is an interesting take on it.
Case of embodied cognition in lucid dreaming would be an interesting one.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
Tell your name out loud before you ask a question, that way we get to know you better.
Yeah, yes. I'm Joe. have you considered dream journals, or do any of these participants keep dream journals?
I asked them if they kept dream journals, and one of them did, and they had them with them when we were doing the interview, just to reference back to remember the dreams.
Yeah, I just wonder what their introspection would be like, or their feelings would be like, having just had the dream, but also later in time, to have had that time to sort of reflect on that experience,
mm-hmm.
and whether that changes or adds new dimension with time.
Yeah, I think it does, you know, because a lot of the dreams are also repetitive, reoccurring dreams, so they get a kind of different take on it. And you know, also when they kind of start out, a lot of them are like nightmares, but then they get resolved over time. And yeah, a lot of them thinking back had new insights even during the interview. They're like, oh, I think that might have been why. But it's also certain brain waves that are active, and I think it is around 20 to 70 hertz in the gamma range.
Research on lucid dreaming EEG?
No.
They
use like a bunch of different methods, so like CAT scans and MRIs and also EEGs.
Just from the interviews or just from your reflections, more I guess just more ideas about maybe the possible interrelations between these themes and sort of how they would bear on I guess the role of these moods and dreams play in introspection, and maybe how that would apply to I guess the VR version of that study. One kind of specific example of this that sort of I was wondering about was you mentioned that the empowerment theme was kind of relevant to a lot of these, and that the facet of that was that there was this kind of transition in this awareness, and so thinking that something was real and then realizing that it was not real, and that sort of becoming aware being sort of important. And so I'm sort of wondering, like, would features like that, for example, you know, how well would that apply to like a VR type experience, where I guess that kind of sense, that sort of suspension of disbelief that is very powerful when dreaming maybe wouldn't be present because you'd be perhaps aware of that experience as you're going into the VR. So, yeah, just sort of wondering like how these different facets of the experience play into the introspection aspect, and which of those would be most amenable or maybe would be a challenge in VR.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, the empowerment is really big for lucid dreaming. But I think the technology like VR, you would already have the empowerment because you know already it's not real. So you're already in a kind of like a lucid dreaming state. You know, I know I'm not dreaming right now. So going into, say, like a virtual environment, you know, I would know that I already have the capabilities to change things. So in that way, I think it's a good fit. I think the challenge is making the experience like relevant, I guess, to each person who goes through it. You know, so I can't maybe just make something generic, you know, because lucid dreams and dreamings are really personal. So how can I transfer that over into a VR experience that anybody could try? I don't know yet.
Related question. I was also going to ask more of, okay, where you see the possible connections between the technology and lucid dreaming and using technology to either support lucid dreaming or make it more lucid dream-like. I was wondering whether you could elaborate a bit on whatever ideas you might have already.
Mm. Sure. Yeah, there seems to be a lot of different senses that go into lucid dreaming. So having some sort of multi-sensory experience, I think, would be interesting. There's a lot of like fear responses too, so you could incorporate like heart rate and breathing and galvanic skin response, things like that. It'd be really easy to just have the watch on. But also EEG could be like your mental state, you know, are you calm?
So is the idea to make virtuality more like lucid dreaming, basically give you some of the potential for introspection you have in lucid dreaming, but not yet, you know?
Yeah, I think VR could be used, yeah, as a tool for introspection. It doesn't really have to be for lucid dreaming per se, but I think lucid dreaming is an interesting example that I think I can use for the design.
Yeah, in lucid dream training, there's often the part of setting an intention for what kind of lucid dream you will have, which would probably help in terms of narrowing down what kind of things you need to simulate in VR.
Mm-hmm. In lucid dreaming is like VR, but with your own memory and with a perfect brain-computer interface, because you actually a couple more questions, but Mirjana, maybe while you ask your question, we can start switching projection as well.
Yeah, so I'll just be here. Excellent.
She's
there
to switch computers.
Yeah, so my question would be, it's more like a comment or idea, is like while we were talking about lucid dreaming in VR, and I was thinking about what would happen if we have a person sleeping with a headset on that like has visual stimulus, and then you make them wake up in the middle of their lucid dream, like wake up and just continue with VR, and then to see whether they can incorporate that story into their lucid dream.
What would be the
point of that? Assess whether it's real or how they perceive it. Oh, this is virtual reality.
Oh, do you mean they can't tell the difference between a dream or VR?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be an interesting application for people who already can lucid dream. So I think I would go more towards people who can't.
Yeah. Any more questions? Eve?
Well, yeah, I'm really curious about the multi-sensoriality kinesthetic experiences that you mentioned that, and kinesthetic sensing that you what you mentioned it a little bit, different modalities. Are there differences, maybe in terms of what you're doing, to how it manifests, how the different senses balance in the experience?
Stimulus of dreaming? Yeah, I think it's different for each person. So one person particularly does a lot of food, so they love food, so stimulus of dreaming, they eat a lot of food. That's just what they need to do. Whereas another person might act in a soft shot and will never have a taste.
Some universals as well that are known. For example, in dreaming, there's no sense of surprise typically, because your feedback loop doesn't work. So when you start flying, for example, you're not even surprised about it so much.
Yeah, you're
thinking. Yeah, is it the, which is another good question for embodiment in dreams itself. But yeah, is there things like that, like universals like that are lost in lucid dreaming?
Lots of people getting into lucid dreaming is a lot of hunger. So they notice something isn't right about the dream. So if you're dreaming and say you're in another country, or you look at a paper and you can't read it, the words are all tangled, or you look at your hands and you look at your fingers, that's pretty common in lucid dreams, and so that would be
How are we doing the battle with the video projector over there?
Get in there.
Second trial.
Yeah, it's common. Fingers. So, like in real life, if you want to train yourself to lucid dream, you're supposed to do these reality checks.
Just a quick sound check.
On that note, let's thank our speaker. Next, we have Mirjana, Prpa, and Katerina Stepanova.
Can we get it on now?
Is this yours?
Just mirror it.
So I'll start while Kivanc is getting this ready. I'm Mirjana Prpa. I'm a PhD student in iSpace Lab. I work with Bernhard, Alex, and others who are not present here. So in this project, and this is Kivanc Tatar, I believe you are familiar with him.
I'm a PhD student here too at SIAT, working with Philip Paske in the Meta Creation Lab, and my topics are musical meta creation, audio synthesis, a little bit of music information retrieval, audio programming, and all sorts of things that are related to music.
So, that was very informative. So, work on this piece that you'll be presenting today, that is titled Pulse Square Water, started about a year ago, and it started by me asking for lunch to teach me Max LSP.
That didn't went through.
No, I never learned Max LSP, but something came out of that.
But we were still successful.
Yeah, it came out as successful. So what happened is there was an open call for exhibition in New York, and we thought that would be a good opportunity for us to do something together, because we were talking about some ideas for a long time, but then the collaboration never happened. So we are like, oh, everyone at SIAT talks about collaboration, so this will be a good way to actually do something together. So what we've done here, maybe I'll just start from the slide here. So Pulse Square Water is an immersive virtual environment that employs breathing patterns, and that is the way to interact with the virtual environment and the object in the environment that is an ocean. And at the same time, there is an audio environment that employs breathing patterns, and the multi-agent system generates sound through this interaction. And we'll be talking more about it in the next 15 minutes. But before we start, I would like to play a little bit. So you get a sense?
Has anyone seen the piece?
Yeah.
No one else. Okay.
So if you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt us at any point.
Thank you.
This concept came from the discussion Kivanc and I had. This wouldn't be possible, and this project wouldn't happen without support from Philippe and Bernhard Riecke. So this is a very collaborative piece where everyone has its own role. And in that sense, Kivanc and Philippe's side is...
We do sound design, effective computing, multi-agent system design, and signal processing. That's the processing of the data coming from the respiration sensor.
And my role and Bernhard's is in VR embodiment, affect, and employment of physiological cues or breathing patterns in this case. So
following question is why would we use such advanced technologies?
So
like why?
Logical reason is because
I could have just played music, right?
Yeah, I know. This question popped up many times in the past year. So, but finally, I think we're comfortable to talk about it. So, VR part. VR is technology, and yes, it's overhyped right now. But it does. It is for a reason, and for reason is that this technology provides high sense of immersion of presence and heightened sense of embodiment that that reflects in self-location, body ownership, and agency. And those are all the topics that actually I'm personally interested in exploring through this piece.
And I included agents because, first of all, they are awesome. Secondly, our computers are super stupid right now. For example, if you open Word, it's just blanks, nothing happens, and I'm like, where's my paper? Why aren't you writing my paper? So, but agents are not like that. You can design a system with some kind of smart behavior, that's intelligent behavior, that is autonomous, that doesn't require human intervention that much, and that is adaptive, and would provide nonlinear media, which is great if you want to make a piece that would sit in a room for a week or 2 weeks.
Or 4 weeks, what happened?
Yeah.
For a week,
yes.
So if you stay there for a while, I mean, the original intention was to immerse someone into this, I'll call it experience, but I'm very reserved by calling VR content experience, to immerse someone in this abstract environment and to provide some sort of stimulus that is unpredictable. And personally, I'm very interested in how little can you give to someone and how much they can make out of it in terms of meaning making. And pretty much in this case, there's no narrative, there's no story. Visuals are very simple. At the same time, audio environment is complex. And it's very interesting, and we'll be talking about it a little bit later, how little you give someone and the stories they come up with after they tried it. And all these stories were very unique and actually comes very deep from their own experiences, previous experiences, not because of this, what we made. So our design goals, we set up some goals before we started working on the environment. And the goals were that we wanted embodied experience through a movement of breathing that controls the interaction, sort of embodied interaction. The idea was to create almost a sense of rapport between a user and the environment, where it's hard to tell whether you are in virtual environment or in the story or you are out, and to create this sense of, okay, this environment reacts to me, and actually it's reacting to your own breathing. We wanted to elicit the sense of disorientation and lost sense of time, and this comes from altered state of consciousness, and this is happening in meditation, and that's the parallel with the breathing and breathing practices in meditation. As well, as I mentioned, interaction is very simple, but at the same time, the environment is complex. And at the same time, we were playing with a positive negative scale of elicited affect. This is more like a future work, so I'm not going to talk in details about it. That's something that we'll be in terms of system design, pretty much we are recording breathing data, sending it to movement and using middleware and LSM. Probably some of you are aware of and familiar with it. And from there, we are sending those numbers to Max MSP and then branching it to Unity and our audio output.
Is there any designers in the room? So there's actually a room in terms of making a respiration sensor available to the artists. Right now, all sensors are super expensive, and it's actually easy to do, but you just need to check some kind of medical information, like, for example, putting the current on human body is not is forbidden. But it's like right now, to buy a respiration sensor, it's like 3K or something like that. So it's not available to artists. That's why no one is using it. And it's actually super hard software-wise to configure it too. So if you're interested and if you're from the makers community, there's something to be done there, I would say. Should I continue? So our collaboration started from a piece of mine that actually named Tuned Ocean that I will play very quickly. And the room temperature is perfect for sleep, so I will just move on. So what's going on there? How did I? So that was a fixed media piece. It was just a recording, 12 minutes. I can't use that. I gotta make it non-linear, right? Because it's an exhibition, and then some people would maybe wanna try it like a couple of times more, and they don't wanna. I don't wanna put people in a medium that's just looping. So non-linearity. So how can I achieve that? First, pulse. There's a pulse there, but I want that pulse to enhance the embodiment. How do I do that? I have the respiration data, and what I can do is just do a little bit of signal processing, understand the patterns in the respiration data, and use that data to generate sound. That is, if someone breathes faster, the pulse starts being faster. If someone breathes slower or stays still, pulse just slows down to a point that it would stop. In terms of harmony, I'm not going to talk about this a lot, but I was trying to find harmonies that doesn't go anywhere, that just stays. And the quartal and quintal harmonies are great for that. And I did an audio corpus, which means a bunch of audio files. How did I do it? I went to this studio, I recorded a grand piano and just played some chords on it. And then I use time stretch and pitch shifting processing to generate like 300, 400 sound. And there is an included effect estimation in sound in the system. That's actually the work in my lab by Jiang Fan, Miles Thorogood, and Philippe Pasquier. But they were working on soundscape composition, and I did the initial experiments with the experimental music, and as an artist, I had a feeling that it would work for ambient music as well, because there's some kind of similarities, in my opinion, as an artist. As a researcher, I can't say that. You know, I got to prove I can. But I felt that it would work. So the study is called Eventfulness and Pleasantness of Soundscape. And I will play some examples from it to show how it works. So this corpus is, this graph shows segments from a very well-known experimental music piece that's called Contact from composer Karlheinz Stockhausen. He's a very well-known composer from 1940s, 50s. He did a lot of compositions throughout the 20th century. And so we will see different segments. We will hear different segments with different valence and arousal labels. What we use here for effective computing is called continuous model, two-dimensional continuous model. And y-axis is arousal, that's eventfulness, and x-axis is balance, that's pleasantness. Pleasantness means the positive-negative emotion continuum. Super eventful. Not eventful. Pleasant. Pleasant and eventful. Chaotic. So it works pretty good to my ears. And then this is the corpus that I'm using in the piece. So I aim for almost like natural pleasantness, but less eventfulness. So it's not going crazy, but still could be a little bit dark, and it still end up being super less eventful.
Curators at that exhibition, actually, this is the exhibition in New York, and it was done in collaboration between Moving Stories, Love and Movement Institute, and One Art Space Gallery in New York. So one of the curators of the exhibition that we didn't know before this event actually really liked our piece, and her name is Virginia Miranda. She's a choreographer that splits her time between Brazil and New York. So she was looking for a piece that, or people and piece, that she could collaborate for another piece. Pretty much it was a kind of combo of her ideas and what she see in our piece. And she was looking for someone to collaborate on the piece for Olympics this year. So, pretty much what happened there, our piece is not the best VR piece in the world, nor we did something very, very amazing, but we were recognized for something we did. There was some quality recognized in it, and we were something that she was looking for. So not to be discouraged, or I mean, it sounds like a big deal because yeah, it was a show for the Olympics, part of a cultural program. You're still down to earth, and we understand what happened. So this collaboration between four of us and Regina actually is very interesting for all of you who are interested in international collaborations, because the process was pretty much done on Skype for 6 months. We were going back and forth. What Regina wanted, she's a choreographer, so she doesn't have this tech background, so she didn't have quite of an understanding what's possible in the space. So pretty much she was asking us for three wall projections, pretty much to set up the cave that it was 10 by 10 by 10 meters. And all of these crazy ideas that we had to kind of
in 2 days. So we were supposed to go there, two people, not just to set up the piece, but also set up
the
cave for a 10 by 10 room.
Yeah, the interesting thing, and I'm glad, because we were looking into ways how to do it or how to do something similar, and in the end, common sense was, no, this is not possible. So in the end, we did one projection of the environment that was run on the Oculus. So pretty much the idea there, I mean, extending from virtual space into physical space, from their perspective, made sense because they had so many people coming for the opening, and they didn't want so many people just to wait in line to try something on Oculus, so they wanted to have this immersive experience in the space. So when we were talking about this for 6 months, it was just when we went there, we realized that in the middle of this huge room, there is a column that no one spoke about for 7 months. So all these ideas of projections
you
and having
this
huge column. So what happened in the end, we had a projection on one wall with Oculus, and on two other walls, there was a complimentary piece done by two people in this
back
audience.
Right.
Yeah, back right. So in the end, it worked out well, but we see how this could have been improved if we knew what are the limitations in the space or what was the general overall idea. So pretty much what we learned, it comes to the director of the piece to think about all these pieces and to manage all the people involved in the process well ahead of time.
It makes sense actually in their perspective, because it takes a lot of money to have such a room, and there were only like three pieces to showcase the Brazilian artwork during the whole Olympics. So they wanted to show it to many people, and that gallery was expecting. So the opening before our opening had 3,000 people. So this time they were aiming for less, and they were expecting still 2,000 people just on the opening day. So it's a huge event, they want to show it. So it makes sense that they just want more visuals, as much as visuals that they can. They just want like more things going on in the room, in a huge room.
So yeah, we had to channel that somehow into something that is doable. Especially we had 6 days in the room, in the space. So
yeah,
it was kind of challenging because they, and on top of everything, they had set designer who designed set design without actually talking to us first. So having set design experience, previous experience, I was pointing at the possible issues because we had a bunch of the equipment that we should have should protect from our life, and it was only like a week before the opening where we're sitting and with Regina, and we're like, okay, so where the equipment goes, and she's like, oh, we'll have a table in the corner, and it was just like, whoa, this is not going to work. So pretty much on the fly, they built
a huge wide room. And they wanted to have tables and computers on one corner, and I was like, no way.
Yeah.
That would look so ugly.
And the cables wouldn't work because you can't have that long cables. So yeah, I mean, we learned a lot from this experience. So if you ever plan to organize such a huge event, now you know what to call. this is the excerpt from so this is the video done by those other two people on their side.
I should mention one more thing. They asked me, oh, hey, you have a system that generates music. Can we also generate Portuguese speech? And I was like, what? And then they sent me a bunch of audio files. Actually, I tried, and it worked pretty good, I got to say. I was able to, so I have a smart segmentation system there. I was able to cut phrases of Portuguese, even though I can't speak Portuguese. So these speech that you're hearing is actually the same system using a different corpus, a corpus of just Portuguese speech.
So what's happening here pretty much vocabulary for these dancers, and they use those 200 cells to combine and respond to the environment. So these are some of the photos from the space.
These are the dancers. And following that, 2 weeks ago, am I right?
Yeah, 2 weeks ago. Could you switch?
Yeah.
So 2 weeks ago, actually, yeah, I was away this summer, and then Kivanc suggested we should start applying to other places to exhibit the work. So pretty much we applied to MUTEC, which is a big electronic festival in Montreal, but now they have VR salon and VR exhibitions. We applied with the idea and thinking that we would go there next August. So, like 2 weeks before the exhibition, we got notified that we are supposed to fly there in 10 days, something like that. So all these ideas of improving the piece didn't happen yet. So pretty much we presented the latest version that we had. And it was for 7 days or, yeah. Maybe you can show. Do we have photos from there?
No, not really.
So that went, yeah, that went.
I think it was 6 days. Yeah, we thought that we were going there in August, and they said like, hey, exhibition is in 2 weeks. So I was like, okay, I guess we are going to Montreal in 2 weeks.
So, yeah, we don't have photos from Montreal, but yeah, that's pretty much all we've done this year. So if you have any questions, comments.
Questions, comments?
Critique, which is always welcome.
Yeah, I was wondering what you plan to do next with it.
We had a bunch of people interested in it. So we send them our proposal, and they will get back to us maybe in a couple of weeks.
No, I think what Alex is asking so is what we are planning to do with the piece. And
oh, you mean like improving it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I see.
So I think from our side, we were talking about creating, doing a research with this piece and looking into how actually measuring whether there is this change in affect after being exposed to the environment. And there are ways to control for that, so pretty much I think we'll be doing that. I'm interested in meaning-making as well and trying to understand what happens and how these stories are created in the process of interacting with something that is as abstract as it is. And pretty much working forward and trying to establish this rapport between the environment and the user in a way that, yeah, there is this connection that is perceived as okay, the system reacts and there is some meaning behind it and there is change in affect as well.
My initial intent for the using the VR was like having an environment that you breathe together, and I have a feeling I'm a trumpet player too, so when I'm practicing breathing, I feel that. So I was trying to somehow have a VR environment in which you would breathe together, as if like it would, for example, expand or like. So I still think that we can improve the interaction so that the environment is just not like something that we traverse, but actually part of what we are in. And I think there is a very interesting connection between breathing and the embodiment. So there's much to discover there.
So there's two feedback loop that can be looked at. One is, right now you breathe in, you go up, you breathe out, you go down, right, mm-hmm. underwater. So one thing you can look into, and we should look into, and we might look into, is whether if you accelerate or delay that, can you modify the breathing through the interaction with the environment? And the second loop is affective computing loop, where if we play pleasant, calm sounds, that it has the effect over time to get someone who is not necessarily the difference between perceived emotion and induced emotion. Is it going to induce the emotion that is perceived from the sound over time or not? And how does that work in VR versus not in VR? And Kivanc, as a future work, can tell you that much. Could we buy in it to do some sound specialization as well as Kivanc in it?
We will do it.
Yeah, I mean, the whole idea with this, the first video that Philippe mentioned was to see how this accurate mapping, once it's inaccurate, influences the breathing. Right, so you breathe in, out, the environment reacts accurately, but then what happens once it's inaccurate? So do you adjust to the environment, or what happens? You?
I'm curious to know how the balance arousal model, how you used it, I guess, within the generative system on the agents or the...
There's a mapping between the frequency of the respiration data, the patterns in the respiration data, and the eventfulness of the sound. That's how I choose sounds, depending on how fast they breathe.
Yeah, and we didn't talk much about the mapping, but the breathing patterns. So the environment has balanced arousal properties, and then I use those numbers in the environment to change the opacity of certain elements or to change the direction. Even the ocean either gets very calm or gets very disturbed and wavy. So the environments actually talk to each other. It's not that like, audio is doing one thing and visuals are doing something else, but they're synchronized.
So there are two things. One is the pre-processing. So I have the corpus. I'm just labeling them with average VA values. And then I use that those VA values to generate the audio. And when the audio is generated, I again compute the VA, a real-time VA. And actually, I'm not playing one sound at a time. So I'm playing multiple times and starting them on between different time intervals. So that's why the VAs and the pre-processing is not exactly the same with the post-processing. So that's why there's also real-time effective computing in sound that's sent to the Unity.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Elgin. I was just wondering, like, when you would exhibit this, how long would people usually like interact with the system that you developed, and was it hard to like connect them and disconnect them?
That's a good question. So it ranges from 2 seconds till 20 minutes. So 2 seconds was, even though we had the environment on the monitor, external monitor, so they were able to tell what's going on. We had the person and she was like, I want to try it. We put a headset on, and after literally 5 seconds, she's like, I'm done. So we're like,
what happened?
That was 2 years. So what happened, she actually has phobia of water. She wanted to try, but it was too powerful for her, so she couldn't handle it. At the same time, we had a person, I think he's a senior. He's maybe in his 80s. He stayed in for 20 minutes. We were worried because he didn't move. We were kind of circulating around.
And there was a performance going on. Eve was performing. It was in New York.
Yeah.
So it was during one of your performances, and we were like, okay, what do we do? And not make a scene and not disturb Eve's performances at the same time.
And he knew he was breathing.
Because he totally didn't move at all, so we totally didn't know what to do, and we didn't want to disturb the experience. So, we didn't set a duration. It's pretty open-ended. I mean, what happens in the exhibitions, like in Montreal, when there are so many people wanting to try, then they have to regulate it in a way to tell them, okay, you know, you can stay in as long as you want, or up till 15, 10 minutes. So there are ways to actually shut everything down. But we didn't set any.
In general, the interaction is like they want to play first. Mm-hmm. They just put it on. They play. They see like what's going on. Okay, what can I do with my belly with this funky sensor? And then they are like, okay, I've done it. I've tried everything. And then they start looking. And then they phase into a
more calm
stage that they just start breathing and stop thinking about how they breathe.
Yeah, it's very interesting how curiosity actually triggers interaction, because in Montreal we had volunteers running it, so we didn't have to sit there all the time. So we usually come there, start everything up, and then leave. And then at some point, I walked into the room and I see the guy with the sensor doing this. And I'm like, whoa, what's going on here? I guess like one of the volunteers was busy with something else, and then this guy just stood up. And he's like, okay, and I'm standing in front of him. It was just ridiculous. Yeah, so, I mean, there are challenges and potential within that field, so,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, maybe, I don't know how much we can talk about it, but
we can have one more question while we switch speaker one more time.
Yeah. With you, we talked a lot about how much free information do you give to, and I guess the fine balance between kind of guiding people to what you think might be an interesting place to experience installation and letting it open.
Yeah, I mean, we pretty much leave it open to them. The only thing we tell them, you will be wearing breathing sensor, and through your breathing you'll be interacting with the environment. You have a head-mounted display and headphones, and you don't tell them anything else. And that's why it's interesting to see after they're done, and to hear their stories, because they're like, oh man, yeah, this story, like when I was surfing in California, the waves, and whoa, nothing that we planned for, but those stories emerge. And
I like saying nothing more than just like preparing them. So we just said like medical things, like if you feel sick, like, let us know, don't stay in there, you may feel sick for a long time. And things like that. We didn't say anything about infraction. We just said like, oh, this is a respiration sensor, and that's it.
You don't give them any information.
There's also one of the undergrad projects, video projects, is also doing a project video on that project that Katerina is presenting. So.
Is it working?
Yes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. So my name is Katerina. I'm also a student at iSpace Lab, and I want to talk today about a very exciting project our lab is starting to work on this year, which is growing bigger and bigger all the time. So I'm just going to introduce the idea to you, and I'll be very happy to hear any feedback. But so right now, mostly it's myself, Denise, Mariana, who just presented, for Alex, Bernhard, and some other collaborators who are working it. And the project is called Earthgazement, or a VR experience of the overview effect. And I'm going to explain in a second what this is. But at first, I want to just reflect a little bit on our current state of the world nowadays. And it's going to be a little bit of a darkened picture, but it is what's happening right now. So we all heard about different climate change, and there's this recent news about all sorts of ice melting in Arctic, and getting worse and worse every year. There's a shortage of drinking water in different areas, and not getting any better. There's all sorts of social tensions and racial tensions and social instabilities, and worse in some parts of our world. And there's a lot of pollution and different type of human impact on the environment, and deforestation, and all sorts of other things. And we all have heard of it, about all of it multiple times. And we know that all of this stuff is happening, but know that we actually have to start doing something about it. And let's look right now at the Earth from a different angle, specifically this one. Let's look at the Earth from the top, and I'm going to read out some quotes from people who get to actually experience this new perspective on the Earth, which are astronauts and space travelers. And that's what they think when they see the Earth from this perspective. When we look down at the Earth from space, we see this amazing, incredibly beautiful planet. It looks like a living, breathing organism. But it also, at the same time, looks extremely fragile. Anybody else who has ever gone to space said the same thing, because it's really striking and it's really sobering to see the paper-thin layer and to realize that this paper-thin layer is the only thing which protects living things on Earth from death, basically, from the harshness of space. That's Ron Garan. You develop an instant global consciousness, a people orientation, and a sense dissatisfaction with the state of the world and the compulsion to do something about it. From out there on the moon, international politics looks so petty. You want to grab politicians by the scarf on the neck and drag them a quarter of a million of miles out and say, "Look at that, you son of a bitch." Senator Mitchell. When you go around the Earth in an hour and a half, you begin to recognize that your identity is what was the whole thing that makes a change. It comes through to you so powerfully that you are the sensing element for the man. Russell Schwerkert. The actual experience exceeds all expectations, and it's something that's hard to put to words. It sort of reduces things to a size that you think everything is manageable. All these things that may seem big and impossible, we can do this. Peace on Earth, no problem. It gives people that type of energy, that type of power, and I have experienced that. Anush Ansari, who is actually a space traveler. And the last quote I want to read is by Roger Chaffee. The world itself looks cleaner and so much more beautiful. Maybe we can make it that way, the way God intended it to be, by giving everyone eventually the new perspective from outer space. So after we get a chance to talk to some astronauts and hear this experience they're going through, Frank Wyatt, back in 1982, conducted all these interviews, and he published a book where he coined the term overview effect, which tries to describe this particular type of experience most of the astronauts go through. So he, in his book, describes it as experience of seeing the Earth from orbit or from the moon, and having a realization of the inherent unity and oneness of everything on the planet. It's a realization that we're all one in terms of our place in the universe and our destiny. It's a shift in consciousness, a shift in awareness and identity, and a harbinger of many more evolutionary transformations. So it's this shift in consciousness which happens to most of the astronauts who go into space. They at some point experience this profound, awe-inspiring feeling where they realize, mostly those two things, they realize how fragile the Earth is, and at the same time they also realize how we all connected together in it with all living species, how there's no borders between different countries, and all of the conflicts we're going through, they don't make a lot of sense when you see this, the Earth from a new perspective. Mitchell also said that went to the moon as technicians and returned as humanitarians. And it has been noticed in a lot of astronauts that once they come back from outer space to the Earth, they usually start devoting their life to some environmental causes. They open different organizations to start promoting all sorts of different things, trying to protect our planet and make sure that we have this beautiful home for many decades to come. And we, after the first missions to space were conducted, we did have an opportunity to see the Earth in different documentaries and pictures, which we have access from NASA. But it doesn't seem that just seeing those pictures is enough. It seems that in order to get the, to actually get this experience and get all of those long-lasting positive psychological effects, which has been reported in different astronauts who got to actually experiencing the Earth, we need to have a bit more impactful experience of maybe actually being there. But so if everyone can get this experience, we can probably live in a better planet. But we can't really send everyone to space. It doesn't seem very feasible, very expensive, not very environmentally friendly. But what can we do? So maybe virtual reality can help. So this is the Birdly interface, which is was presented at SIGGRAPH, and it provides a very compelling flying experience through a virtual environment. So maybe something along those lines could help us. So this is a great time to work on this project because virtual reality technology finally becomes more accessible and more compelling. And it actually can provide you this opportunity of being there without actually going into space or other areas, but you can experience it. However, it's still a very young field, and there is still a lot of questions remain unanswered. So if you want to design an experience for impact, we want to design an experience for behavioral change in people, or a design experience for education, it seems like there's a lot of potential in virtual reality, but we don't really know what specifically should we focus on, what is actually the key component which results in people experiencing being out in space, experiencing maybe the overview effect. So maybe what is important is having the embodied interaction that you actually use your body to go through space. Maybe the interactivity is the key component which distinguishes between virtual reality experience and just watching a documentary, or compelling visuals, immersiveness, or maybe VR is just novel and so people get more excited about it. Those are all questions which need to be tackled. So what we're proposing to do in this project, we're going to design a set of affordable, interactive, intuitive flying interfaces, maybe a magic pillow, where you can lie on a pillow and get a little bit of sense of weightlessness and fly around in space. And this will also distinguish us from a lot of other flying interfaces which exist in the world, but they tend to be very expensive and take a lot of space, which limits the amount of people who can actually experience them. Another thing which we want to focus on is getting participants ready to be out. So we're going to look into creating this openness to the experience in the participants by introducing some priming before the actual virtual reality experience, and also using some biofeedback like breathing sensors or EEGs to make sure that before being going to this key moment where we hope that we can get this glimpse of the overview effect in people, the participant is actually ready to perceive it. We also are going to develop a set of evaluation methods to be able to assess how successful the experience is and whether there's actually an emotional reaction and whether there's a behavioral reaction to the experience. And we're also going to set up a life science lab at the Riecke Space Center where we can get access to some participants and get them to participate in science. So I'm going to show you a very initial prototype of our interface. Magic Kilo, so we're actually the Kilo there. So it's possibly going to look something like that. So you're laying in the field and you use your own body to fly around the space to the Google Earth demo. So you can use some motion tuning of your body leaning in different directions in order to get a bit more of a feeling of flying and moving to space, and also provides a bit of weightlessness in order to feel comfortable on your pillow, and it's like you're suspended in air, similar to if you were diving. I'm going to say a few words about our collaboration with Space Center, which is going to start in the beginning of next year. So we're going to put our demo in their exhibition space, which will provide us with access to visitors, and so we can get a lot of feedback on our interface, which will help us iteratively develop this. And it will also give us access to people to maybe give them a little bit of the overview effect. We also going to get some guidelines from our collaborators there on how to develop exhibitions for education outside of regular classrooms. And we're also going to see some contacts with alternates, and it will be very exciting to actually get some alternates that go through the virtual reality experience and see what they think and how different it is them. Actually going out of space, which is a very unique and exciting community. And so this is a very diverse project which involves experts from multiple different areas. From the technology side, we're going to focus on developing this motion tuning interfaces which use your own body leaning in order to move to virtual space. We're also going to use biosensing both for the interaction with the interface and for the evaluation of the effects. From the theory side, we're going to use embodied vision principles and immersion frameworks. And it's also kind of an artistic project where we're going to use the actual space footage to create the visual imagery and narrative taken from the interviews with alternates and maybe delivered by the alternates. For the evaluation, we're going to mix methods analysis and separate different physiological and behavioral and social measures. So it's a very big and complex project, which is a stroke that the session in interdisciplinary place of theater is a great place to actually make this project happen. So I'm very excited about that. So this semester, we're running a preliminary study done by Denise. And collaborators. So she is measuring awe and emotion in the interaction with the virtual environment by using this bump effect and some narrow correlates. Hopefully we're going to see some exciting results next week. There's some really cool things. And see about that. So some benefits of this project. First of all, we're going to create a number of affordable flying interfaces, which might be incorporated for different other applications, like flight simulations and trainings, and overcoming fear of flights and such. We're also going to analyze significance of different components of VR, which is hopefully going to help us understand how actually can we design the virtual reality experience for change and for education. For emotional reaction. But most importantly, we hope that it will maybe increase awareness of how fragile our Earth is and will unite us all together to actually start protecting it. Because we all know that our Earth needs protection. We all know that we need to make sustainable, environmentally cautious decisions. But just knowing it consciously, it doesn't seem to be quite enough for us to be having in that way. So we really hope that if we get people to experience it from a cell, like from within, from some kind of embodied way, and seeing this perspective, kind of not just hearing about it, but actually just getting it, then it will help us develop a better relationship with our home planet. And we're just not going to be able to do anything to hurt it, because it just will be very unnatural. So that's a help. So thank you for your attention. So this is, again, all the people who are working in this project, and we'll be interested to hear if you want to collaborate with that. We also have some international collaborators. So
please, questions, yeah. Comments?
But I'm not sure if it's relevant, but I remember Steve Paula has a paper on the Beluga project he did,
mm-hmm.
from the perspective of how the the affective relation for participants between the simulation and the real Beluga. So I don't know if it's relevant.
Yeah, good point.
And then you mentioned priming,
mm-hmm.
As a way to enhance the experience. I'd love to hear more about that.
What exactly would you like to hear about? So the idea is that before we want to focus a little bit on what participants are doing before they actually sit down and putting the headset on. So we're going to design the experience a little bit earlier than what you would normally think about being a VR experience. Make sure that while they're getting ready to go sit down in the interface and put the headset on, they're already presented with some information which will prime them to experience this overview effect. That makes sense. Yeah.
So astronauts have at least 10 years or so of experience. Current experience is obviously you cannot provide that.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, okay, what are really the most important aspects? So that's, again, an open research question. And we know from theme parks and so on, they very carefully create these priming tunnels and priming experience to get people into the state where they would be more susceptible. And to us, that's a key question, basically, to see whether we can use this to accelerate the process. Because obviously, we cannot simulate weightlessness. So we cannot do everything, but maybe if we focus and really research, okay, what are really the key aspects, we can just kind of focus on these, kind of like the MP3 approach. If you know exactly what you need, maybe you can leave out other things that aren't quite as important.
More questions, comments? I have a comment, more so than a question. Do you know the work of the NCSA Advanced Visualization Laboratory in the US? It's Donna Cox, and they do similar things with, they've been focusing for the last 15 years almost with NASA in the US at a VR representation of the universe and how people can navigate the universe and eventually navigate the history of the universe. And there's a strong pedagogical stake there too, because in the US they're facing some denial of, you know, of the way things were created eventually. And
yeah.
So they're really working out on, like, you know, how can we get those big data visualized in a way that will actually be realistic and convincing. And so there's a persuasive aspect in their work as well. So maybe there's some paper there that would be
interesting. Yeah. There's a few organizations which are working towards a similar direction where they try to provide this space flight experience to regular population. What we're doing slightly different than them is that they're focusing on providing the most naturalistic observation, like real one, while we're focusing specifically on the experiential side of it and this effect. So it's not going to be as realistic, but hopefully we can, by focusing on what's happening inside the participant, we can actually get them more susceptible to that experience.
So that's where the artistic components come in, like in black box theater, where you have very little means, but you can have a very strong emotional response. We'll probably take a lot of shortcuts and a lot of liberties, basically, in designing not for the visual appearance, but for the emotional shift and the cognitive shift. That's the idea.
I would just like, because I'm involved in the project, I would just like to add that actually this effect is kind of considered to be one of the altered states of consciousness. to like shift cognitive shifts that happen. And I think it's very, it will be very important to see what are the mechanisms to get, if it's possible, to get people there and what contributes to this shift. So looking into those parts will be very interesting because then, yeah, like for other projects might be useful. Mm-hmm. To know how this actually happens, what are the contributors, because we don't know, all the reports we have are from the people who are trained, very engineering-oriented minds, so their reports of the experience might be very different from the ways that one of us would report if we were in space and experienced it. So those are all open questions.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Well, some of that actually grants going off that point. I was curious whether you had looked at all at some of the literature that sort of relates, say, the attitudes of adult conservation scientists, natural historians, to sort of their significant early life experiences, because I guess that would maybe get around this issue where you have a bit of maybe even somewhat of a more extreme kind of selection bias with just sort of the engineers or the astronauts and such. But maybe I'm wondering if some of the qualities of those nature experiences that also are spoken of in these sort of transformative terms and kind of like a perceptual and a cognitive shift. If you think that insights from not literature might at all be relevant to this as well, or involve similar mechanisms there?
It would be interesting to look at. So far, the only correlations we've came across that, like, people compare these two near-death experiences. And, yeah, that's the only thing we have heard people really trying to correlate this type of experience to. And we obviously don't want to make people go through near-death experience, but it seems to have similar type of effects. And it would be very interesting to find something else which results in a similar type of effect, which is a bit more positive.
Well, near-death experiences are like life changers, and usually in positive ways, so I don't see any issue
with making people go from near-death experience.
It's just a certain too realistic. Yeah, but it's the
problem. I mean, if you have to suffer a little bit and then have some benefits from the experience.
Yeah, but Emily brings up a good point. I mean, so a lot of conversational, a lot of people who are really convinced of something and go for it. I mean, they have had some experiences that are very strong and very pivotal. And I think this is an interesting usage area for virtual reality to really see how can we use the power of these to really create these experiences without necessarily spending tons of fossil fuel or being like seriously near death. That's how to get through ethics.
Another then point on that is there's a code of ethical conduct for virtual reality that a team in Germany has issued. Thomas Metzinger is the well-known philosopher who is leading that team, and it's good to follow that because they're still researching the effect of VR, for example, on children, and they find that rewiring of the brain is quicker than we thought, and just something to watch.
Yeah, definitely.
Maybe ethical applications in VR are going to become harder and harder when those research advances. Who knows?
Yeah, it's a huge. Well, my prediction is it will become a really huge topic once you have the first law cases. I mean, right now, if you believe the idea of virtual reality, and this is really emotionally, perceptually getting really close to reality, then half of the games out there will immediately traumatize people. So I think we have a lot to do in terms of ethics to really prevent that from happening. I mean, just don't do anything in a game that would, in the real world, traumatize potential people or have other negative side effects. Right. It's that simple.
Any more questions, comments on that positive note?
Well, just I am really curious as to where this will go, and I guess this idea of strong transformational experiences that can happen in relatively brief times, I'm very curious about that, and I would link it to some experience I've had through somatic practices, and I'm interested how they evolve over time, because one of the things and this is just from my personal experience, so very little sample size, but that, you know, there were very strong experiences in the beginning, and that over the years of practice, actually the experiences are not quite as punchy, but become more rich, nuanced, mm-hmm. but don't have that awe effect that the first times have. But then at the same time, there's a lot more potential as the experience gets richer and more nuanced. So I'm really interested in those dynamics of how that evolves over a long time.
Yeah, definitely will be very interesting.
Yeah, so that's one of the open research questions right now, is exactly that, like, is it one moment that's really the pivotal one? And it's, sometimes it seems like that, but it's kind of hard to interview astronauts while they're out there, because they can be out there for a few days.
Yeah.
Or I wonder if, like, the one moment gives you the motivation to do long-term work that then kind of extends that vision.
Yeah. So far, it seems like there is some preparation for actually experiencing that moment. There's a lot of stuff which happened before that, but then there is the pivotal moment where you're like, "Whoa!"
Yeah,
now I feel that.
It's the priming, as you say, that you have to be right for it.
Yeah. And then there is a long-term consequence of it, which, like, once your perspective changed. It's changed.
I think that's where the EEG and biofeedback and biosensing comes in. So can we sense when people are kind of ready, or can we only give them the experience once they are in state, basically? Because beforehand, once their mind is still out there, they're thinking about whatever, that's probably not going to work. So let's not even try. It's almost like they need to get ready before we send them out into virtual space.
All right, if there's no more urgent questions or comments, then we can...
I think there's one question.
Since the Zoll effect could be used to actually show the difference between actually what the implication of climate change or something like that is, projecting future, like, possibilities of what will happen with different climate change and we don't have to do anything to climate change, using this technology, like VR systems, to actually project what would happen to the Earth and see that implication on participants, and that could be something interesting. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's definitely could be. So far, it seems like just even showing how the Earth actually is enough to make people start being a little bit more concerned about their current state instead of thinking about climate change. Like, a lot of astronauts report on being really moved by seeing how thin the atmosphere actually is, and how it's fragile when you see it from out there.
How it's fragile like that, that means that something could drastically change it and make it more unlivable, and that's how it will be.
Yes.
Could happen. That's what I'm making.
We definitely thought about the options of kind of like showing different types of Earth. Yeah.
Well, there's actually, if you do sort of go that route, there is somebody that did those kind of studies, but just sort of, they were called just sort of like visioning experiments, and they just sort of had people basically like sort of mentally visualize those kind of scenarios and provided like different sorts of sort of sensory probes to help them with them, and it was, I mean, you know, kind of like smaller studies, but suggesting that they could be pretty effective, so it could be interesting, actually, to sort of do that with VR and be so much more tangible and potentially a lot more effective. So if you want, you can, I can send you those references.
Yeah.